a 19-year-old female who presented with short stature, not attaining menarche, and some associated hearing abnormalities were also present in this child. So we have.
Yeah. So if you have now got this finding, short stature with growth failure, we discussed last time the three possibilities: CDGP, systemic illness, NPHD, and Turner
syndrome.
Now, if you look at these three things: short stature, primary amenorrhea, and hearing abnormalities. Your Venn diagram, your three things are now mixing.
Yes, sir.
Which of these are out?
So CDGP is out.
Yeah, so 19 years, yes. CDGP is out.
Amenorrhea is, MPHD is out.
MPHD is out.
Less likely. Hearing abnormalities, I love with that.
Hearing abnormalities most likely suggest?
Turner syndrome.
But you cannot exclude some of the syndromic associations can cause this. So this is like, to me, two possibilities.
Yes.
One, you talked about Turner second syndrome. Is?
HH, hypo, PHP.
PHP. Pseudo-hypoparathyroidism will also cause a similar picture.
So, continued history. So, she gave no history of anosmia. There was no history of any headache, diplopia, or seizures. No history of any recurrent ear discharge, suggestive of Turner syndrome. No history of tetany or posturing, suggestive of hypocalcemia, secondary to PHP. On examination, her vitals were stable. Blood pressure was normal in all four limbs. All four limb pulses were also felt. No Turner stigmata, such as shield chest, low posterior hairline or the facial features, no brachymetacarpia, no cutaneous calcification suggestive of any pseudo-hypoparathyroidism, no eye or ear abnormalities, no anosmia, dental abnormalities, orofacial malformations suggestive of the various hypo-hypo features, no skeletal malformation or spine defects suggestive of hypo-hypo or any of the DAX1, etc. or other SOX9 deficiencies which can cause these problems. Yes, so the anthropometry over here, so suggestive of definitely the height was affected at -3.4 SDS, but weight was also affected -5.84 SDS. Pubertal development was interesting here, which showed that there was pubic hair development, but no breast development or other features.
So if we go back to our last discussion, we have a short girl who has got a normal pubic hair development and who is not looking sick.
Hmm.
Diagnosis?
Hypo. Isolated GnRH deficiency.
So it goes more in favor of a isolated GnRH deficiency. You cannot exclude Turner syndrome here because there are also pubic hair development may be normal. So these two will be the possibility. But having said that, you've seen so many features and no features of Turner syndrome at all, which means isolated GnRH deficiency is likely. So but why is she short? That's the other thing itself which comes.
That is going against the picture.
So that's a bit confusing. If you say it is MPHD, then why is she having pubic hair? That means the ACTH is not affected.
Yes.
So let's not go into a complete listing. That means ACTH axis is normal.
Mm.
But height is affected, which may mean that she is having delayed puberty. That's why the height is affected. Or there is a concomitant GHD,
defect,
which might have happened.
Mm. So her systemic examination was normal. So coming to the investigations, initial investigations showed that first of all, systemic examination, the hemoglobin was normal, creatinine was normal, thyroid profile was normal, TTG was normal. Now, what is important is here we saw that the low LH levels compared to the estradiol levels, the LH levels were low, FSH was low, and estradiol was low.
So, what do you see out here? We have said that if the LH is more than 0.2, it means that there's a pubertal onset.
Yes.
So, don't you think it's 1.2 LH? Is it significant or not?
I would say it is significant because it's still low compared to the estradiol levels.
It is very, very low for a 19-year-old girl. We are talking about puberty. When you talk about in the beginning, if you're, it's more than 0.2, you have entered puberty.
Yes.
But if somebody is 1.2 at 19 years of age with an estradiol of 12, she should have had much higher LH levels for this level of estradiol. That basically, what does it tell you now? If you think about this way, where is the problem? It is central.
Yeah.
Is it hypothalamus or is it pituitary?
It is a pituitary or different.
It is more like
a hypothalamic. Okay.
Because if it was pituitary, your LHFSH will be zero.
All of that, correct.
So that's what you see usually.
Okay. Somehow,
it means that this is more like a subtle GnRH deficiency, some GnRH effect. If you talk about Kallmann syndrome,
usually
you will see LH less than 0.1. So it's not like a complete deficiency. Yes. This is a partial. Maybe the neurons were there, those neurons were damaged or whatever is happening in that. But it looks more like a hypothalamic thing. Now, your BMI is less if there was a recent onset deficiency with regards to the weight and all, then you can think of an anorexia situation also, but there was no development to begin with. So it's something which has happened from the birth, which is continuing, and you have a clue that there is a deafness. So now if you talk about deafness with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, possibilities?
First is Char syndrome.
So, of course, Char syndrome becomes very, very important. So, what is Char syndrome?
So, Char syndrome is a combination of various features. First of all, coloboma of the eye, heart defects, genital defects, ear defects, atresia of Koehner, and retardation of growth. So, this is where retardation of growth comes in this picture.
I think, again, this is a very interesting case. Short stature, normal pubic hair development in non-sick child with a low LHFSH. It's hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. And in the context of deafness, Char syndrome would be the most likely possibility.
She was evaluated and the MRI was normal. So as sir said, we have a congenital hypogonadism. Now, why Char? Because three of the features are already there, such as retardation of growth, genital abnormalities, and ear defects. We need to evaluate further for the other features.
So again, the message which comes out of this case.
Next. Yes. Yeah.
So the message which basically comes out of from this case basically is that there is a need to have a comprehensive evaluation. Clinically, you will get 90% of the diagnosis there. You can talk about a bit about follow-up. Yeah.
So basically what happened in this individual, we had started her on estradiol valerate therapy and she responded very well. Even initially, there was breast aging 1, which improved to 2, and by 1.5 years, she'd actually reached menarche. Following, we started progesterone therapy as well. So we'll come to the third case. Now here we have a 24-year-old female who presented with primary amenorrhea, absent secondary sexual characteristics.
So now the age is going up.
It's going higher.
He talked about 15, then 19, then 24.
24.
So when you go up the age, the likelihood of physiology goes up. This is pathology.
This is pathology. Now, very important history in this individual was that there was a history of neurotuberculosis 12 years back and she was treated for 15 months. On examination, her height was fine, her weight was okay, BMI was 16, and pubertal development was B1, P1, and A1.
So now we talk about a normal height girl with delayed puberty and no pubic hair development. So we talked about short stature, no pubic hair development, sick was systemic illness, short stature, no pubic hair development with normal child. We're talking about CDGP. In this case, we have a normal height for the family with no pubic hair. And what do you think now in that perspective?
So one significant history is the neurotuberculosis. And even if we don't think of that, we have a B1, P1, A1, so that's of multiple pituitary involvement. So we can go further.
So it means both the adenarche and the gonadarche
have not happened.
Discrepant, and that's why you can have an MPHD-like picture which may happen. Yes. So what it means is your history was very good. You said that 12 years of age, she had received neurotuberculosis, which means that she was normal by that time.
Yes.
So she grew up till that height. Maybe after that, there was a destruction of the multiple pituitary hormones which happened.
So she was further investigated and by investigation, everything was just confirmed. If we see the TSH is 18, but for a low T4. So TSH is not appropriately raised for the low T4 over here. The LH is low, the FSH is low. An important point is that the cortisol was also low and suggest prolactin was moderately, but I would not consider that significant.
Just hold on. This is a very, very characteristic report that you will see. This is very important to discuss each and every part of it. Now you are saying that T4 is low, and TSH is slightly high. So we normally say more than 20. Mm-hmm. Some people talk about more than 10 also as a criteria for diagnosing primary central hypothyroidism. Mm-hmm. So this, from our criteria, looks like a central hypothyroidism. But many people will say, okay, 18 is pretty high. Mm-hmm. We will consider it like a primary hypothyroidism. Why is this TSH high? Why is TSH high in central hypothyroidism?
So the reset of the axis happened because of that?
No.
So the subunit, the different beta subunit.
The TSH may be
bioinactive.
So when you are actually having a problem in the TRH, the way it is being produced is that your bioinactive TSH may be there. So that may be one cause. There is another cause which may explain a high TSH in this case. why is the TSH higher than a normal central in this case? Pratik, you should be able to think about, just look at this table, you will identify that cause.
So because of the low cortisol levels, it is.
Yes. So cortisol suppresses TSH, and if you have cortisol deficiency, you may have a falsely higher level of TSH. Maybe if you just give hydrocortisone and you do a TSH level after 3 to 4 weeks, it will come down to 10 or 12. So this is the other cause. So bioinactive TSH and the lack of deficiency of cortisol is what is causing, in this perspective, the problem in terms of that level. So now the two things that you have seen is cortisol deficiency, you have seen the thyroid, and the LH is very low. Mm-hmm. So this means there is a damage of the DNA, neurons are gone. It's not like the second case of charge where they may be low. Here it is less than 0.1. So they're completely gone. The other point is prolactin. Mm-hmm. What do you think about prolactin? The problem is in pituitary or in hypothalamus?
Prolactin. It's a hypothalamus.
So it is not a pituitary problem. This looks like a hypothalamic problem. Mm. That's why your bioinactive TSH becomes important. Mm. Your CRF deficiency, your GnRH deficiency becomes important in that setting. So this report, if you just look at it, is extremely important. If you find it, make it a final diagnosis, this is a multiple pituitary hormone deficiency with ACTH, GnRH, and thyroid deficiency, most likely hypothalamic in that situation. So which hormone you will give first?
So I will be just explaining that. So we are, it was an acquired multiple pituitary hormone, secondary to neurotuberculosis. So the course of events, we first started her on tabhizone and the hydrocod replacement. After a month's time, we started a low dose of thionone, which was eventually increased. And then we started her on estradiol replacement. And then by the time she was P1 and she gradually improved to B4, P4 when we started her progesterone therapy.
So this is a very important thing. If you give hydrocod in that setting, you will have at least covered the adrenal insufficiency. Otherwise, the problems would be there. Now, my question is, when you add Progynova, what do you expect in terms of the response? Like, what hormones will be affected when you add Progynova?
So first of all, cortisol deficiency might occur because it increases the metabolism, and thyronorm dosage may be changed.
So you're right. Your requirement of hydrocort and your requirement of thyroxine will go up.
Yes.
Why?
So because the metabolism is increasing.
No, not. I'm talking about thyroid. I'm talking about estrogen. When you start estrogen, both increases. Why? What does estrogen do? How does it affect the
active? So basically,
it increases the binding globulin. So estrogen will increase the CBG, estrogen will increase the TBG, and because of that, you will have more bound faction and your requirement will go up. So whenever you start estrogen in a multiple pituitary hormone deficiency child, always be wary that there is a risk of having an increased requirement for thyroxine, increased requirement for hydrocortisone, which is there. So this is something which is extremely important from that perspective. So this one case is very, very helpful in explaining everything about that.